Oh, I thought, sorry. After all of that, my friends, I am so glad that, and I don't mean this flippantly, that there are not new concerns added. May we see this as a blessed week with a lot of joy and celebration for people who are recovering and healing. And may we rejoice in that as we come to quiet our hearts and our minds and our souls, and we come to worship God.
This is a responsive reading for the gathering words. So for the number one, it'll be the choir responding. Then for number two, it's these two sections. And then for number three, these two sections. The living word speaks. The living word calls. The living word promises. Come to hear and follow the living word. Come and let us worship God. Loving God, we come asking and searching and knocking, longing to see your kingdom of heaven come to earth. Open to us today the goodness of your word. Feed and strengthen us for the journey ahead. Then walk before us on the narrow road and surround us with companions on the way, that we may both receive and share the blessing. Amen. Over and over, we are told how simple life with God can be. Trust to do good to others. Take delight in the wonders God provides for us. But we simply have trouble living such a life. Let us confess the struggles we have as we bring our prayers to God, saying, Holy One, you created the world in love, and yet we so rarely reflect it. We confess that we have built a house on the foundation of your favorite traditions, our likes and dislikes, a rose-colored view of history, and a sense of being more right than they are. We admit that we have judged other houses without ever being inside and resisted too much scrutiny of our own. Forgive us, for we have not treated others as we would want to be treated. Forgive us, for we have repeated your words, but rarely acted on. Forgive us. We have blamed the music and the decor when the real problem was far deeper. You are our rock, God, and we pray you would help us in the storm to move from shifting sand to firm foundation, even if it means letting go of the old life and building anew, going beyond lip service and putting your love into action. We ask in the name of the one in whom all authority dwells, Jesus the Christ. Amen.
My friends, God is not done with us, not by a long shot. You are more beloved than you can ever know, and God is working in you and in the world beyond our wildest imagining. The beginning of all of that is forgiveness. So know that you are indeed forgiven, and be at peace. Our peace comes from knowing how much God loves us in Jesus Christ. With God's help, we try to love and forgive one another as Christ loves and forgives us. May that peace of Christ be with you all. Do I have, well, they're coming. All right, today you got to come sit kind of close and behind me, because otherwise you're not going to, well, if you don't want to see the pictures, that's quite okay. Oh, I see the pictures. Can you see the pictures?
Oh, yeah, I see the pictures.
All right. So, I know what you all learned in Sunday school this morning, I think. We're maybe all on the same page or close to. And one of the things that you learned about this morning is the golden rule. What is that? I forgot you? No, you just didn't come. But I'm so glad you came. What is the golden rule? You were saying, go ahead. What's the golden rule? Don't smash anybody's gold. We'll work on that. I will find the gold first. Go ahead, Nathan. Yes, treat others the way that you would like to be treated. That is the golden rule, and that's what Jesus talks about and what I'm going to talk about. But here's another thing that happens today, or not today. Well, happens this whole month. Does any of you know what month this is? February. What happens in this month in this country? What do we celebrate? No, not quite yet. We're getting there. We'll get there in February, but not quite yet. So you're not far off. What? Well, Valentine's Day come too. Do you know? Oh. We'll sing to you when that happens, okay? It is Black History Month. Do you guys know that?
I think I had that on the calendar. It was on the Google calendar.
Yeah, it's the whole of February is Black History Month. So I thought you've already learned about the Golden Rule in Sunday school, that maybe we can read a story about Black history a little bit together today. How's that sound?
How are you gonna hide?
Oh, well, so I can show you the book. Okay, all right. Hold on, Dove. So have you guys ever heard of a lady called Rosa Parks? Yes. What can you tell me about her? There's one thing she's really really well known for. Do you know what that is? That's okay if you don't. We're going to read her story. Any of you? What?
People had to stand up in the way. People had to stay on the bus. And there was a part that arrested for not getting up.
Exactly right. Exactly right. She did not move when she was told on the bus. That's exactly right. So we are going to learn a little bit about Rosa Parks. Yes. So short. She was a shorter lady in real life. She was not a very tall lady. So let's read a little bit. So this is Rosa Parks. She says, "Growing up, I was small for my age. I was sick a lot too, since we didn't have money for a doctor. But that didn't mean I was weak," she says. And then she tells a story. She says, "When I was 11, as I was walking home from school, a boy on roller skates came zipping by and shoved me. He thought I was an easy target. To his surprise, I turned around and pushed him back. I knew fighting was wrong, but I didn't want him picking on me again. His mother saw what happened, and she was mad that I pushed him. But you know what made her even madder? I was black, and her son was white. And she started yelling. No question, it was scary, but my mother and grandfather taught me to respect myself and to expect respect from others. So instead of backing off, I stood my ground and calmly but firmly explained, 'Your son was the one who pushed me. I didn't bother him at all. I was just standing up to that mom, or even to the boy on the roller skates. I was standing up for myself. After that, the boy and his mom never bothered me again. But still, it's hard to change things, and sometimes that can take a long time.'" And we'll read the next story, the story as it continues next Sunday. But there's one thing that we can already learn from this today.
What?
Well, you told me. What can we learn from it? Yeah, say what you said, because you were right on track there, my friend. What did you say, Nathan? Say it out loud. Yes, we should treat others the way we want to be treated. Exactly right. Yes, Dove. Yes, you can. Saturday. I have no idea. Oh, Groundhog Day. That's right. That was yesterday. You're exactly right. So are we getting more winter? What did the hedgehog say? I know. Sucks. No, well, that's a good idea. I think your mom is right on, and she's a nurse, so she knows. So, but one thing we can learn already is there are people that look different than us sometimes, and they think we are different and they can do bad things to us, but we'll always treat them like we want to be treated, right? Yeah. Yes, ma'am. Ooh, you learned something today. And we're gonna, yes, it's in the Bible. Good for you. Let us pray. Holy God, thank you that you love us so much. Thank you that we are worthy in your eyes. Help us to love others as much as you love us, and to do to them like we would have done to ourselves. Amen. Thank you, guys. Thank you, Finn. You came.
That's my boy.
Okay, this is the new prayer that is taking the place of the prayer of Great Thanksgiving. So it's the prayer for God's wisdom and guidance. Empty us, great God, of all that prevents us from hearing what you want us to hear. Empty us of our preconceptions, our preoccupations, and our prejudices. Empty us that we might be filled with your Spirit and your Word. Empty us that we might be filled for ministry and mission. In Christ's name we pray. Amen. The first reading today is Matthew chapter 7, verses 24 through 29. Everybody who hears these words of mine and puts them into practice is like a wise builder who built a house on bedrock. The rain fell, the floods came, and the wind blew and beat against that house. It didn't fall because it was firmly set on bedrock. But everybody who hears these words of mine and doesn't put them into practice will be like a fool who built a house on sand. The rain fell, the floods came, and the wind blew and beat against the house. It fell and was completely destroyed. When Jesus finished these words, the crowds were amazed at his teaching, because he was teaching them like someone with authority and not like their legal experts. The words of the Lord.
Follow me to Jordan, follow me alone, follow me to Jordan, follow me all the way home, follow me to Jordan, follow me.
We almost don't need me. We'll just have Peggy and the choir and all the beautiful singing, and then we'll be all set for Sunday. Don't you guys think? So our second reading for today is sort of, you were closer to the end of the Sermon on the Mount. You do your reading before mine. I'm going to start at chapter 7, where you read the end of chapter 7. But this is sort of the wrap-up, the end of the Sermon on the Mount, at least, where we're getting to today. So, and I'm going to read to you. I really love this translation, and it's just maybe for us to hear things a little differently one more time. Let it fall on our ears to hear in a different way. So we're going to read Matthew 7, verses 1 through 14, but I'm going to read for you today, and you'll see that's the Lord's Prayer that we're going to do after, comes from this version too, the First Nations version, which is an indigenous translation of the New Testament. So let us listen for the word of God today, Matthew 7, verses 1 through 14. If you do not want to be judged, then do not judge others. For the way you judge others will come back to you, full circle. Think of it this way. How can you see the speck of wood in your own, in the eye of another when you cannot see the log in your own eye? How can you say, here, let me help you, when you cannot see that you need even more help? Stop pretending to be something that you are not. If you will be honest about yourself, you will then see clearly enough to help others. Take care to not give what is sacred to the ones who will turn on you and treat you with disrespect. For who would toss an eagle feather into the dirt to be trampled on? Let your prayers rise like the smoke to the Great Spirit, for he will see and answer you. Every step is a prayer. And as you dance upon the earth for the things you seek, the way will open before you. And in the same way, as you search for the true ancient pathways, you will find them. Answers will come to the ones who ask. Good things will be found by the ones who search for them. And the way will open before the ones who keep dancing their prayers. What father, if his son wanted fry bread, would give him a stone to eat? And if he asked for a fish, would he give him a snake? If fathers with bad hearts know how to give good gifts to their children, then how much more will the Great Spirit, who is your loving Father from above, give good gifts to the ones who ask? And here is the meaning of what I have been saying. Whatever good you want others to do for you is what you should do for them. This is the whole purpose of the instructions given by drawn from the water, which is Moses, and the words spoken by the prophets. To walk Creator's good road, you must enter the small gate and walk a narrow path that leads to the good life. Only a few find and walk this road, but the gate is large and the path is wide that leads to a bad end. Many walk this road. This is the word of the Lord. So there's this story. It comes from the Talmud in Jewish tradition. And it talks about a Gentile guy who came to Shammai. Now, Shammai was a famous rabbi in that time. And he came to Shammai and he says, I want to convert, so I need to learn the Torah, but I want you to teach me the Torah while I stand on one leg. And Shammai had no patience, of course, for this ridiculous request and thought it very disrespectful of this guy, and he threw him out of the study room. So this same fellow then went to Hillel. Now, Hillel was a contemporary of Shammai. And he asked Himal the same question. And Hillel looked at him and said to him, "Whatever is hateful and distasteful to you, do not do to your fellow men." And then he said, "This is the entire Torah. The rest is just commentary. Now go and learn." Does this sound like the golden rule? Yeah. Does this sound maybe also a little bit like God and Jesus' commandment that says, love God with all your heart, mind, soul, and strength, and love your neighbor as you love yourself? And then while I'm asking you all these questions, why do I not just keep on going and ask another question? How much of this, that this is the Torah and all the rest, this commentary, sounds maybe a little bit like what Jesus is leading up to in the Sermon on the Mount towards the Golden Rule? If you go back a little bit when we started with the Sermon on the Mount, the Beatitudes, the salt and light, and all of that good stuff, right, on how we live, the Golden Rule, this one thing, sounds to me like what the Sermon on the Mount sort of builds up towards. That these words are sort of the core of what it means to be human, to be children of God, right? To share God's love and to be citizens of the kingdom that Jesus came to inaugurate. You know, all those things that we talked about, to seek God above everything else, to be peacemakers, to be humble and meek and merciful, to hunger for justice and righteousness, and to not retaliate when you are persecuted, to be the salt and the light of the earth, to not have angry thoughts, to not murder, to don't commit adultery, to keep your promises, to let your yes be your yes, to turn the other cheek, to love your enemy, to give your coat when they ask for your shirt, to go the extra mile, to pray in humbleness for God's will, to fast where no one else sees, and to give without wanting praise or notice, and to not worry about tomorrow. Doesn't that all sound like do unto others in the end? Like, this is how we live the golden rule. And then Jesus continues, of course, just before we get to a golden rule, and he has this whole story about do not judge. Now, this judging, my friends, is not like the great British bake-off show where everything that comes out of the oven is judged, even the flattest cones, right? This word in Greek means to condemn. And if I want to be a little more specific about it, it is to condemn to hell. Now, I've never seen a flat scone condemned to hell in the big British bake-off, but you know, that's another story for another day. The problem for me comes if we read the next sentence that says, because how you judge, in that same way you will be judged, or by that same measure. And if judge means condemned to hell, then what does that mean for me if I condemn to hell? Ouch. Right? How we will be judged. All right. Sorry. Technical difficulties. I'll be right back with you. And the reason I asked that question, why maybe that's stuck in my throat a little bit, is how we all tend to judge. I mean, can we be honest for a minute? And I'll be honest right up front for you, because I'm really good at that. right? Especially when I hear a name like Jerry Falwell, or I can name some names, but my point is, when someone, this is the quickest judge I am, is when someone doesn't quite believe the way I do, right? I'm okay with people looking different and maybe being from a different culture, but this thing about not loving as Jesus loves always sits for me crossways, and this is my judgment. It's that judgment that says, why do a bunch of Christian people have to go and protest at the funeral of gay soldiers with white pickets, right? Why do those who say that they are pro-life kill the people who work in abortion clinics? I don't quite understand how that works. How do you say you love Jesus and you put kids of immigrants in cages? This is where I get really, really judgmental. And if I judge this way, am I judged in the same way? And this makes me stop and think a little bit, because those are my hard things. But how many times too have we looked at an addict and thought, man, just get yourself together. You know, this cannot be that hard if you just stop using. What is so difficult, right? Sort of the attitude of this is something that can be overcome, or the people who live in generational poverty. It's like, if you just pull yourself up by your own bootstraps, maybe the next generation will have it a little better. I've been there. I worked with homeless. I've worked with poor people in Maine. I have been there. Maybe it is a subconscious thing that sits in biases and prejudices and preconceived ideas that we've heard or looked at or seen from childhood. Once again, guilty, growing up in a country that shoved apartheid and racism down our throats. But if I judge those who are different from me so easily, how will I be judged? And maybe here's the point. Maybe Jesus understood us better than we know. Maybe Jesus living into our culture, who chose to came and live in our world where everything seems like it's one big judgmental mess, knew that if we looked inside for a minute, that if we did some introspection, that might just go a long way. That as long as we cannot see our own faults, we cannot have compassion on someone else's. That before we don't see the things that lay in our own souls, we should not look at the problems we see in someone else's. It makes me wonder if it's so easy for us to judge others or see other flaws because they lay within us. You know that psychology thing they talk about, right? Are we afraid of what people might find in us, and so our best defense is to first say how bad they are before they see our own faults? Is it maybe an acknowledging that we suck enough to that we can find compassion to say that someone else doesn't suck as much as we think? And then I wonder if we start looking at people through that lens with mercy and compassion and forgiveness, like we've learned in the Sermon on the Mount, that we might be judged with mercy and forgiveness and kindness too. And I wonder if we can then start to consider the stories that brought these people we just talked about to the places in their lives I mean, can we consider maybe, do you guys remember the shooting in Charleston, the AME church? Okay. You remember the Parkland shooting? The first thing that was said by the, I think it was the governor of Florida, was like that he was a monster. And it's easy to judge and say that, but how about the stories we heard afterwards about his childhood? How he was abused and bullied and kicked around? And I tell you what, if that was me, I might have turned out a lot differently than standing right here in front of you too. That doesn't make what he has done right, but can we look with mercy and compassion? Can we stop to consider that the woman who goes for an abortion after she has been raped is not a baby killer? Can we maybe see the immigrants who come here fleeing all kinds of gangs and danger and violence to bring a better life for their families? That's what we all want, isn't it? Isn't that a common thing? And realize that the journey that they come across, being raped and being murdered and being whatever to get here, can we maybe consider that before we so easily talk about how they take our jobs, before we put their kids in cages? Can we look at the young woman on the street begging and maybe know that her family abused and threw her out because she was gay? I wonder if we start looking at others the way that we wish people would understand us, that maybe we can judge with mercy and with compassion, that maybe we can offer those that are different from us the same love and acceptance and worth and dignity that each one of us long for. But then Jesus acknowledged it, right? He said, this gate is narrow and this road is difficult. And I don't think that was talking about sweet heaven by and by one day. I think Jesus was talking about how hard it is for us to live this life, to live in ways, to forgive in ways, to pray for our enemies in ways, to turn the other cheek in ways like we would have done to ourselves. And I'm just thinking about Black History Month. We started to read Rosa Parks' story with the kids. And how much do we need to consider while we celebrate people like Martin Luther King Jr. and Rosa Parks or Maya Angelou or Fannie Lou Hamer or Mamie Till, you know, the people who try to make it better for themselves. We celebrate that. If this also becomes the place where we need to maybe re-examine the way we live and have done to us or done due to others as we would have done to themselves, because we live in a system that is skewed. I have nice European skin. I worked hard, I got what I wanted. I'm here. Not all of that was just me. Not even by a long shot. We think about the racial justice of this criminal justice system and how much more it is skewed to those who look different from us. We think about the healthcare system and how we have benefits when it is unaffordable for so many. And the data and the statistics that's used in healthcare does not even consider race. Maybe this month is also the month that we consider how we seek peace, how we hungry for justice, not for us, but for all people, so that they are treated in exactly the same way that we are. But the gate is narrow, my friends, and the path towards life is difficult. A path to treat one another with worth and dignity, every single one of them, and I've got to talk to myself here, is hard. To be the church that swim upstream from the culture that favors money and fame and power and good things is hard. To live a life where we give more than what we hoard, and to realize that God provides every day as we pray, give me this day our daily bread. That is hard. And to not worry about tomorrow is hard. But it's possible. So let's end with what Rhonda read for us today. Because yes, there is the fool who build on sand, right? And the clever guy who build on a rock. But I wonder if you caught in there one little thing that says, those who do the words I just said, not hear them, but those who do, they have built their houses on a rock. It is fine for us to stand here for 3 weeks, or for me to stand here and for you all to listen to me for 3 weeks about the Sermon on the Mount. And it is fine to have nice thoughts about the golden rule and who are blessed and being the salt and the light. But until we get on this narrow road, until we participate in the hard paths of life, until we afford others the same things we would like, until we do all these things and not just hear, we will always be on sand. God calls you to a life, my friends, which is not easy. Don't be fooled. But these words are foundational to our lives, and it is our mission. A life in which we are called as beloved children of God to see everyone else as a beloved child of God, and so establish God's kingdom. The one that Jesus came to show us when he stretched his arms, and how much he loves us, we can show it to the rest of the world. May it be so. Amen. be seated. So we are all here for different reasons today. I don't know what yours look like, but I know we are not all here with our hearts in the same place and our lives in the same place and our reasons in the same place. And that's okay, because see, all the people who followed Jesus to that mountainside came for different reasons too. Some because they found out about him and was excited. Some just because they were curious, maybe. Some wanted to know what all the fuss was about, and some longed for healing, whether it was in their spirits or in their bodies. In the end, it didn't matter that why they were there. It only mattered that they were there. Whether they were brimming with faith or had just a tiny speck and were holding on for dear life or felt maybe lukewarm. We are here for many different reasons, my friend, but it doesn't matter why you are here. It only matters that you are here. That you are here when God welcomes all of us to come join in this feast and celebrate at the table. In this place where there are no walls or judgments dividing us. This place where Christ simply said, take, eat, drink, and remember, all of you. So let's gather in. Let's gather at this table today, wherever and whoever you are. Come at Christ's invitation as he welcomes all of us. And we are in need of this food. So come. All right, so just turn one page back. Go to above the scripture. That's where I'm at as we come to pray. May the God of Epiphany be with you. Be still and wait patiently for the one who loves you. Trust in God, my friends, who delight in all of you. We come, O God, knowing that you delight in us and that at the first moment of creation, you spoke, O God, of still silences, and all that was good, including us, were created in your image. And you gave us your heart's desires so that we may live as your children. But we dishonored your hopes and committed ourselves to sin's ways. And you sent your prophets who reminded us that salvation is from you. But we continued to play in death's dusty streets. So choosing to be ever gracious, you sent Jesus to us, not withholding anything from us. And holy are you, God of every moment, and blessed is Jesus Christ, our Savior, who, having shared in creation with you, he came to remind us that by the gift of resurrection, we cannot destroy ourselves or anything which you called into being. Loving us even when we were enemies, he came to do good to those who hated him, giving his other cheek to sin and death. He did for us what we could not do ourselves, defeating their power over us. O God, from the grains of the field, you shape the bread of life for us, and from the fruit of the vine, you fill the cup of grace for us. And pouring out your spirit upon these gifts and upon those gathered around your table, you provide that brokenness which makes us whole enough to go and serve a hungry world. You do not hold anything from us, but pass us the cup of simple grace, which cost everything that was dear to you, so that we could love those who are not easy to love. So we could pray for those who would speak hate to us, so we could do to others as you have done for us. And when our journey comes to an end, when we are gathered with our sisters and brothers around the resurrection table of wonder, we will sing your praises forever, God in community, holy in one. Amen. My friends, on the night of his arrest, Jesus was gathered with his disciples in an upper room sharing a meal. And on that night, after he gave thanks, he took the bread and he broke it. And he gave it to his disciples and said to them, "This is my body broken for you. Take and eat and do this in remembrance of me." And in the same way, after the dinner, he poured the cup, telling them, "This is the cup of a new covenant poured out for you for the forgiveness of sins, for you and for many. Drink from this cup and do this in remembrance of me." For my friends, as long as we eat from this bread and drink from this cup, we do proclaim the death of our Lord Jesus Christ until he comes again. Know this. These are the gifts of God. Amen. Come and join in the feast. And I'll serve you after to serve and I'll come back. This is the body of Christ broken for each of you. Eat and remember. friends, this is the blood of Christ shed for every one of us. Drink and remember. Let us pray. Holy God, we thank you for your grace that meets us and calls us and fills us and guides us. And today we offer ourselves to you in gratitude for your teaching and trust that you will receive our commitment and use it for your glory. God of glory, in this holy meal, you show us your will for every meal. And in Christ's strength, let us live and work the day when all tables are filled with your abundance and surrounded by your people in peace. Today, we also come to you and we ask for your mercy for those who have been judged harshly, who feels the sting of betrayal, that they may experience unconditional love. And we ask your mercy for those, including us, whose default attitude is judgment. May they too experience unconditional love and discover the possibilities of new ways. And help us to be honest with ourselves and with you and choose to walk the narrow road that leads to life. That all may see your hand guiding and your love reflecting through us into this world. We ask these things and all things in the name and authority of Jesus the Christ, who taught us to pray, saying, O great Spirit, our Father from above, we honor your name as sacred and holy. Bring your good road to us, where the beauty of your ways in the spirit world above is reflected in the earth below. Provide us day by day the elk, the buffalo, and the salmon, the corn, the squash, and the wild rice, all the things we need for each day. Release us from the things we have done wrong, in the same way we release others for the things done wrong to us. Guide us away from the things that tempt us to stray from your good road, and set us free from the evil one and his worthless ways. Aho, may it be so. Amen.
Jesus said, give and it will be given to you. A good measure, pressed down, shaken together, running over. For the measure you give will be the measure you get back. Now is the time to present our gifts and offerings to God with praise and thanks.
Thank you.
Source of every blessing, you sent Jesus into our lives to save us from selfishness and greed, for teaching us to treat others as we would have them treat us. We give you our thanks and praise. Bless these gifts that we have received from your bounty and send them forth to those in need, whether they be friend or foe. For all are your beloved children and our sisters and brothers.
The road is narrow and the path is difficult. But the life on the other side of that is awesome and blessed, and it is God's kingdom. It is peace and mercy and grace and justice and all the things we all long for deep in our hearts. So this week, go out and treat others the way you would like to be treated. Because in the end, that is God's kingdom here and now. And as you go, may the Lord bless you and keep you. May the Lord make his face to shine upon you and be gracious to you. May the Lord turn his face towards you all and give you all his everlasting peace. Amen.
perfect.